Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Young Baka. This is the B-Side Forum. We get together every Wednesday night. We discuss all things hip-hop, all things life, all things business, and anything else that comes across this table. I got a special guest with me, the two-time or the three-time guest, MC Remedy?
Two-time,
okay. Yeah. I guess I introduced yourself. Introduce yourself, yeah, anyways.
I'm MC Remedy. I'm from the A1A right here in California. How we doing?
Your green mic is a little bit loud. Blake, introduce yourself, Playboy.
Yep.
My name is Analog Dive, also Blake Borisov. Name me either or. Rapper and booker at Los Lobos.
The key to Silver Lake, right? They had the presentation, oversized key, and you're in charge of Silver Lake now.
I guess. I can't find the hole for it yet.
There you go. So you can't be in charge of Silver Lake. Go ahead, Playboy.
Yo, it's your man Alcatraz, man. Hip Hop Alcatraz, LA Battlegrounds, West Coast public figure.
I'm going to start saying that. That's good.
Right? For hip hop, man. You know, yeah, I'm, you know, shit. Everybody knows I rap, do different things, but now I just want to be known for just a guy that's known for hip hop.
I respect that, man. So let's jump right into it. Before the cameras got on, we were discussing how hip hop has such a bad stigma at Los Globos. And then you also spoke about you wanted to see if you could do some battle rap situations, but battle rap has a bigger stigma in, you know, in the venue, the concert promoting. How does somebody that runs a battle league get over that stigma when you bring up battle rap, the owner, the GM of the venue doesn't just jump out the window?
Just convince them to let you have an event, and once they see how you run your show, just like Baka seen how we run our show and having us back at the airliner, you know what I mean? And once they see the professionalism of how we run the program, then they'll be like, oh, okay, this isn't as bad as, you know, we thought. A lot of times it's just, you know, you can't control every situation, but you can diffuse a situation really fast. Like, you, like certain shit shouldn't go as far, you know, you get what I'm saying? Like, and it stops right at the door. Like, one of the main things when I talked to you when we did the event, you said you were going to have the security. Cool. You know what I mean? Make sure that these dudes are pat down at the door very well. And if they do have anything, they're not allowed back in here. PM.
How do you get over that, Blake, when somebody brings up an avenue like battle rap? How do you politely tell them that we don't want that kind of drama here at our venue?
I say, it sounds dope. Let me talk to Sire.
That's it, right? That's it.
No, I would definitely chop it up with you. I would take a look at what you have as far as promotional-wise. Like, if you sent me some past recap information or video photos of previous events, and the way that you're saying it, the way that it is, it sounds great. That's the kind of hip-hop that we do want, battle rap or not. And of course I would try to convince the staff otherwise. So
absolutely, I mean, 5 years and no altercations, you know what I mean? So that's one thing that we,
which is impressive. There isn't a lot of promotion companies that go 5 years without any type of altercations. Doesn't matter if it's battle rap, hip-hop, rock, punk, it doesn't matter. There's always people that, because all it takes is one bad apple to jack it up for everybody else, right?
Right,
plus absolutely. There's alcohol in the mix.
But it's a delicate line, because we want you to get super drunk, right?
Exactly.
We want you to get super drunk, but then we want you to behave.
Responsibly super drunk.
A lot of people can't handle that, though, you know?
Or they can't handle being dissed when they're drunk. You know what I'm saying? Then,
so how do you deal with an MC Remedy when you're drunk and a woman says, I don't want anything to do with you? How do you handle it when you say, you know?
Well, if it's a woman in the situation, I just smile and wave and leave.
How do you overcome?
Not too much to do there.
How do you overcome the stigma of being a rapper in 2017 when everybody's a rapper?
Oh man, well, you know, I do have to overcome that every day. Every day I meet another rapper. It's true, and every block I go. By the way, I feel about it, I'm confident in myself and the style I have and what I bring when I'm on stage. The difference about it is the amount of energy you give off on your stage. If you have a good aura, then people follow you, and if you have a confidence, you don't have a problem with it.
How do you overcome that stigma before you get on stage? Because I have people coming to me all the time saying, I'm a rapper. All right, cool, you rap. I know a million other rappers. How do you separate yourself from that?
There's many things that can separate you from it. You know, professionalism could be one of the things, plus the people that you bring. When you do a show with that person, or when you meet that person, the kind of people you bring to the show, you know, hey, you know, you come, you respect, you know, because I don't want to lose my promotion over anything, and I will come at you with that professionalism from the beginning, and then eventually, hopefully, you get to hear me on stage and have the respect for me musically because of my talent.
How do you separate yourself when you tell everyone that you're a rapper? How does that happen? when everyone just doesn't put you in this pile of, okay, you'll rap like everybody else.
Well, when I tell them I'm a rapper, they usually laugh.
Why do they laugh? But in 2017, no one's laughing at you when you say you're a rapper.
I laugh with them, too, because I know what their response is going to be, because I have a hard time. I don't have a hard time. I just carry myself normal. I don't try to put on a persona, I guess.
So do you think most MCs, most rappers put on a persona? They're playing rap.
A big portion of them do. These gentlemen seem perfectly normal.
Because you're able to have a conversation with them. You're able to look.
Exactly.
Half of these rappers, you can't even look them in the eye and have a conversation with them because they've never been outside and beyond the keyboard. You know what I'm saying? They're just used to being on SoundCloud all day. They can't have a conversation with people.
He said hi to me when he walked in. Like,
and that's not often, right?
Yeah, out of respect, professionalism. You know, you never know. You know, we might become real. You know, something might happen, and you know, I might be one day working with you. So I always gotta, from the beginning, introduce myself with respect. You know,
exactly.
Like, always as an artist, that's what's gonna set you apart.
Yeah, and you know what? It may not just be. I mean, rap is a big part of it, but anyone that has an ego in any kind of genre is gonna have that sort of stigma. But for some reason, it is boosted more with hip hop because it is you, just you. You're not in a band, so it's more self-centered, I guess. But
it's a lot of pressure too. It's a lot of pressure for you to be you. You know, it's a lot of pressure for you to be different. And you
get
have
drunk,
to overcome.
Blake. Come on, man. Start taking these down, dude.
Trying.
Start
remember
taking
what
these
happened
down,
last
dude.
Time? I got drunk off one Paps, I think, right?
I know. That's why I got this much. This is what we do at the B-Side Forum. We put a whole bunch of alcohol in front of people. We hope that they drink a little bit too much, enough to get home safe, but a little bit too much where they say things that you won't usually say.
You did say these were mine, so I'm sharing with everybody.
That's fine, man. It's all yours. I don't think you don't drink, do you, Trez?
Nah, I don't.
How do you live your life without drinking? How do you go to clubs, and how do you sit there without having a drink in your hand?
I mean, shit, you just don't do it. You know what I mean? That's really
smoke?
Power to you, man.
Do you smoke?
You know what? I haven't been buying packs of cigarette. I do bum them from people to cheat because I still been cheating in that sense where I'm like, oh, you got a cigarette? Shit, let me hit that. But I haven't been. It's been about maybe like 3 months now that I haven't bought a pack of cigarettes.
Ah, man, that's awesome, dude. Congratulations.
So, you know, thank you.
And listen, it's hard to afford cigarettes nowadays too, right?
Yeah, it's just crazy. I mean, look, I'm going to tell you the truth. Like, every now and then I might have if I do drink, I'll drink some Hennessy on the rocks with some maybe like some Coca-Cola and it's usually now with Uber and shit, I feel more comfortable. You know what I mean? Because now I can go, oh, okay, shit, if I want to have a drink, that was one of my main reasons
you
for
got
never,
designated
for never
driver
at
your
shit.
Disposition.
Right. And then you know, but this I never acquired a taste for.
Like, just don't like how it tastes.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, and I've tried different ones. You know what I mean? Homies were like, oh, try this one. And I was just like, I don't get it. Like, you know, I mean, I know shit. People drink that shit like it's soda, bro. But
it's water right here, actually.
Yeah, there you go. No, like I hear people say like, oh, man, you know, a nice cold beer with a slice of pizza. And I'm like.
That's it, man. That's it.
But you know, it's good, though, to people. Shit, I'm not knocking it. You know what I mean?
I love the way beer tastes. But yeah. I'm saying, though, when you're on hour 5 of the event, I don't know how you don't just crack open a beer and start drinking, man. That's the only thing that gets me through it.
Nah, discipline,
well,
man.
You know what it is?
That's one thing I lack is discipline. So.
No, well, you got to understand, like, I know people know, and, you know, I talk about, like, I really love hip-hop, bro. Like, the energy of just being around a motherfucker. This dude rap. This dude, you know, he does, you know, club promotion. He raps. I know, you know, me and you go back. Got the DJ here, like... The essence of it all, like this, that's just that thrive. That makes me thrive. That gives me energy.
So you're
like,
not jaded by hip hop, because there's some nights where I'm. Last thing I want to do is go to a hip hop show. Last thing I want to do is be another, you know, on day 4 of a week of a hip hop show.
I mean, on what aspect do you get jaded, on the business of it or through hip hop?
Yeah, but you get jaded on the business. It can't help but bleed into the music side of it as well.
You know what? I've never had that problem. I mean, I've had bad events and stuff, you know, or things that didn't work out that way, or, you know, we fucking, you know, were upside down and stayed upside down type shit, you know, didn't even break even, but it never, you know, and it jaded me to like, damn, you know, shit, should I do another event? But never like, oh, you know, fuck hip hop. Like, nah, I don't know. Like, it just.
I don't think I've ever got to this point where I said fuck hip hop, but there's definitely been days where the last thing I'm going to do is listen to a hip hop album. When I just had 5 shows in 1 week, it just jades you out a little bit, you know?
But that's the thing. Like, hip-hop, when you say listen to hip hop, I guess that's what it is, because hip hop not just music, it's just a form of life.
It's a culture.
It's me waking up, putting on my J's, the way I put on my shorts, the way I put my hat on backwards. When we talk, the way we conversate, that's hip hop. You get what I'm saying? Like, it's the fact that, you know, I know your history. I know your struggle. I know that, you know, what you've told me and how you lived and how you were homeless at one time and all these like different things like that. Like, you know, some of my struggle, how I went through my divorce and, you know, I had to start all over again. And, you know, I'm in Inglewood still. You know what I mean? Like that, to me, that's hip hop, homie. Like that's where it really came from originally, is the inner city, you know, of it. So I hear what you're saying. Like, I don't feel like listening to rap. Like right now, I pulled up listening to Bootsy Collins. You know what I mean? Rather Be With You. Like, that's what I felt like hearing. But yeah, like, I get it. You know, sometimes you don't want to hear rappers, or I don't necessarily, I got battle rappers hitting me up like, yo, check out these battles. Send me like 20 links. I'm like, bruh, I got to the point now where, like, when they're like, yeah, I want to get on the LABG stage. I'm like, okay, cool. Send me your two best links of what you think is your best performance. I said, let us check them out. Let me talk it over with my partner Woods and we'll get back to you. You know, and I just kind of dead it like that, because I'm going to watch them. That's one thing that I will do. Like, if they send me two links and they say it's their best shit, I'm going to watch at least their first round and see. Because if I don't get nothing from the first round, then I just don't get
That's
nothing.
All they have. They have one round to get your attention.
Do you get a lot of inquiries or emails where it's like, yo, put me on, and then that's it?
I get a lot.
I get a shit ton of those. I'm like, yo, I want to perform at Los Globos. I'm like, all right. Like, first of all, what's your name?
You get those random things. But I think those are people who are just eager to try to get out there, and they don't know how to approach
they're
properly.
New.
That's all.
It's mean for us to joke about it.
How do you keep yourself from getting jaded? Someone that literally walks inside of a nightclub.
That's hard, dude. Yeah. The love, the passion, remembering where you came from, knowing that that's just a piece of the much larger pie. Of course, any job, like even just when I used to work at Starbucks, so you're going to deal with asshole customers.
You just couldn't look at any more coffee. That was it, right?
It actually wasn't the coffee. It was the customers, you know, like the fucking...
The hipster guys that come to Starbucks have to drive you crazy, right?
It's the fucking entitled motherfuckers that sometimes I feel like they're fucking with you. Like, can I have a upside down cappuccino with pesto sauce on top? And like, it's like, what the fuck?
Half a shot of espresso with just a sprinkle of cinnamon.
Yeah, and then you finish it, and I'm like, this is not the way I wanted it. I'm like, fuck you. But whatever.
There's still people that they order a drink that has 10 different steps, and they give it to you, and they say it's a little bit off.
Wait, what? Repeat that one.
Were customers, when you worked at Starbucks, that ordered like a drink that took 10 different steps to make, and then you would give it to them, and they would say, it's not what I want.
They would want it exact.
I would be so embarrassed to say that, right? I would be so embarrassed, but that's where the entitlement comes in, right?
Yeah, exactly. It's just the one rotten apple. You got to remind yourself to not let that one rotten apple to fuck everything else up. Like, go for it.
Now, I was going to say, and that actually goes back, people of entitlement goes back to the rap thing.
Yeah,
a lot of rappers have that sense of entitlement.
Yeah.
But they, here's the biggest misconception, and we talked about this plenty of times one-on-one, Bach. And this is what I'll say. A lot of dudes carry, okay, because as an MC, be proud. You know what I mean? Have a certain essence about yourself. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like a certain arrogance to you. That's cool.
Yes. Yeah.
But that's as an MC. It's different when you take that and put that into your personality and you start treating people like that.
You got to be humble.
Yeah.
Then people are
like,
but these guys, they don't know how to, I don't want to say separate, because we want people to be real, right?
We
want them to be real, but then we don't want them to be that cocky asshole when we're talking about doing an event together or something like that. But we still want them to be 100% who they are. It's a delicate line of balance.
Yeah, but I mean, it's just, it's especially when you're handling business, there's still a certain level of respect, and I think sometimes people don't necessarily keep that boundary of respect.
Well, I think the whole generation, there's a big generation that's missing respect just in general.
Oh, fuck,
and there's
yeah.
a big generation that feels entitled, like they deserve to be on it, and it has to bleed through when you have battle rappers, especially battle rap. Some they have to be egotistical, they have to think that they're the best. So when you tell them you have to do a catch the fade, or they have to do a proving clause, something like that, they're like, I don't need to do that. I'm the best, you know? So how do you deal with those egotistical battle rappers?
Show me your numbers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they always have that excuse, right?
No, there's no excuse at that point. Where are your numbers? Oh, I've battled here. I've battled there. Cool. But show me a battle where you battled on another league that doesn't have the buzz that a URL has, or King of the Dot, or Guerrilla Warfare, or us, LA Battlegrounds, people who necessarily might have a, you know, because our channel, one thing about LABGs, you have to be very special to hit them numbers. You get what I'm saying? Because our channel's still growing. So that's where I hit them with. And then I'm also like, you know, show me that battle where you did numbers. Because if your name is so hot, if you're so hot, then you could put him up against, in the words of Woods, Jimmy the Cheeseburger on Backyards Battle League, and it's gonna do them numbers. You know what I mean? If you did that, oh yeah, I dropped this shit, Joe Schmo, you know, blah blah blah, and we did 200,000 views. Now I'm going, that's fire.
Because you know it's because of their name and not just the battle league that they're battling under.
Right.
It's easy. I don't want to say it's easy, but it's easier to get views on King of Dot and UOL because they have that built-in fan base.
Absolutely.
Especially if it drops on like main page, you're going to have people just watch it just because it's on the main page.
Right. But see, that's also the other big misconception too, is that they think because some artists think because they get on those platforms, like they're popping now, and it's like, okay, you got on there and they're fancying you, but what did it do for your career? Did you become a K-Shine? Did you become, did you become a Briz? Did you become a, you know what I mean? Like a Twerk or a Mike P? Like, did you become those guys? Because those guys have, like, Mike P steadily moving up. Like, he's probably going to be the man in the next year, probably next year or two. You know what I mean? He's going to be one of those guys to beat on URL. So that becomes the question right there.
But that always goes back to the ego. When you say something like that, most of these people can't separate, okay, he has a good point, to, oh, he's dissing me. So they just take it as, oh, he's dissing me. So if somebody hits me up and say, hey, Bach, I want to get main stage, Weed West, put me on 11 o'clock. I'll say, well, truthfully, I don't think your fan base is there yet. We'll start you off here. We'll start you off there. They take it as I'm dissing them, and I'm saying they're not good enough to be up there.
Yeah, well, at that point, go ahead, bro. I'm sorry.
You know, as much as...
Yeah, Blake's about to explode,
right?
No.
There's a flip side to it that I actually don't agree with, but it is the other side. It's like, I agree with you, and I feel like we're all kind of on the same page as far as, you know, how people present themselves. But as much as you don't want to see it, and even though you see on the big level mainstream, the image, blah, 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 even with your down here, image is still important. It's still very important. And even
I think in life, image is important, right? The way you carry yourself, the way you dress,
yeah.
Make sure you got your hair cut. Blake obviously doesn't care about that, but, you know, you're presentable.
I'm getting a haircut this Saturday, man.
There you go. Jesus. First time in 6 months, right? Hey, listen, I make fun of people's hair. I make fun of people's hair because I can't do it myself.
Blake got that Brad Pitt thing going on.
Brad Pitt.
Listen.
He can get away with that.
Don't let Blake play you. Blake does great for himself, man. Don't let him play.
I believe it.
With his wrinkled T-shirt. Blake does great for himself.
Those are the dudes that pull all the hottest girls.
Exactly.
I clean up.
The beard, huh?
You know,
the
I forgot to shave up here. Help the cameras.
Yeah, no, I appreciate
stubbles.
You coming on my show with 5 cameras. You don't even bother to shave or iron your
with
T-shirt.
With a stain on my shirt.
Listen, I make fun of people's hair. I make fun of your hair because I can't quote any to save my life.
I took no offense. No offense. Just a little.
So what's the flip side of it that you're speaking of?
Is it sometimes people like the bad guy. Some people like the egotistical prick.
In wrestling, everyone loves the bad guy in wrestling, right?
Sure. Yeah.
I take everything back to wrestling. That's the way I live my life, dude. Yeah. But people like the bad guy, but you don't want to do business with the bad guy.
I personally do not. I never.
Anybody that wants to do business with a bad guy.
No.
No, but sometimes on as far as the followers. And that forces a guy like me that may want the money more to book that person.
Yeah, because you see the numbers and you're like, dude, you want to get that.
But that makes sense, though. That makes sense.
You got the numbers.
You can't be the bad guy and you don't have those numbers.
Yeah.
That's the flip side
that's
of
what
it.
That's
exactly
where
what you're saying. I mean, I'll deal with a dickhead all the time, bro. Like,
as long as he's got the numbers, you know, he's producing.
I'll just say this. I book Billy Boondocks. You get what I'm saying? Like, Billy is one of the most difficult individuals to deal with. But he's fucking amazing at battle rap, bro. He's super talented. but he's so hard to deal with. I haven't booked him since, but just because.
But imagine if he was easy to deal with and he was super amazing. But then is being super amazing, it's like, where does that line stop? Well, maybe is that what helps him out? Because I know artists that are super amazing, they're super creative, but I can't get him to show up on time anywhere. Not only I can't get him to show up on time, I can't get him to show up an hour late somewhere. You know what I'm saying? But that's because they're so out of control and they're so out of their mind. That's what makes him a great artist.
I would show up.
Go ahead.
No, it's right, though. It is... The way the person carries himself. But you know, if he's got the numbers, it sometimes it's part of their persona to be the bad guy. Like if they're not the bad guy, then that same those numbers wouldn't be the same. You know, and sometimes people like he said, people do like the bad guy. But they don't start off as the bad guy.
They don't.
When they don't have those numbers, they don't start off as a bad guy. You can't be the bad guy like that.
Case in point.
Just knowing.
Floyd Mayweather when he was Pretty Boy Floyd, bro. One of the most, nobody ever talks about this when we talk about Floyd. He was a very humble guy. All he would say was, you know, he wanted a shot. He wanted this. He was asking Mosley for a shot. Mosley wasn't giving him a shot. Then when he became the man, oh, now he's ducking Mosley. Fuck out of here. I remember when he was asking you for a shot and you didn't want to give it to him. Now he's the bad guy. Well, guess what? He chose to be the villain because he goes, oh, Money Mayweather. People don't like him. They want to watch him.
And they want to see him get knocked out. Yeah. So I'm going to pay this $55 to get the pay-per-view and see him get knocked out. Yeah. And he's not going to do it. Next time, you hope he's going to get knocked out. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But listen, it's easy to deal with a dickhead or someone that's unprofessional if you're walking away with a lot of money at the end of the night, right?
Yeah. True.
It makes it a lot easier, you know? Do you disagree with that?
No, yeah. You're such a hippie.
You're such a hippie, man. You're such a hippie, dude.
It is. No, because I got lost in him pointing at me, and then you asked me the question. My brain kind of short-circuited. Wait, just repeat the question.
The fact that you're in charge of booking at one of the most popular nightclubs in Los Angeles blows my mind, dude. Because every time I see you, you look like you have this glazed look on your face, like you don't know what's going on, but you're the man, so what do I do? And I think that's all image, too.
I really don't know why. I don't try to put on a persona. I don't know. I didn't even. That's really cool that you
don't
said
think that.
That
you make yourself a little bit different to stand out from everyone else that raps.
Because
I think there's a lot of artists that make themselves a little bit different to stand out.
I just try to be myself, I guess. I really do. I try. Because you and I had this conversation. It goes back to being that. I feel like it's much easier to be an asshole. And you got to really fight against the grain to really be yourself, or you really just give into it and you just don't give a fuck anymore. Of course, we all get tougher. Like, we all, like, are a lot more firm as we go along in this business the deeper you are. But, you know, it takes a lot to hold on to your roots. And I'm very prideful on that, and I don't want to let go of it. So I
is it getting harder to be a nice guy the more you climb up the ladder?
Oh, absolutely. It is. And you know... I think you and I had this conversation too before where there is a line of being an asshole and being firm. You don't need to be a fucking dickhead. Just say no. That's not going to happen.
Hey, no, it's not going to work out for us. And if, you know, this is what we could do for you. If you can't do it, it's fine. It is what it is.
Yeah, there's no hard feelings. But, you know, so many people get emotional.
They take it as you diss them. That's
why. And it's up to you to be the bigger person. To just be calm, and if they're giving you shit, it's just another bad day at the office.
Bad,
you know,
day at the office.
It's not like you're gonna be at Starbucks. Go mad at Starbucks. I you know, what's so funny is I think I learned a lot from that stupid job.
Makes sense. Yeah.
You wouldn't be on the other side of the counter snapping at the guy because he's pissed at you. You would get fired.
Sorry. No. Yeah. No. That's right. No. I've had to work in situations like that too. And points where it's just like those customers are coming at you. You can't really do anything about it. I mean, as far as like, 'cause they're not disrespecting you, you know what I mean? Just like that. Just like as far as the artists are not going to the other level of disrespecting you, they could be dickheads, you know? But
yeah, but here's the thing also, and this is another thing that I think some people
great job, Emily. Great job.
Some people don't do is sometimes, I don't know if you guys actually force yourself to deal with shit. Sometimes you don't have to deal with that shit.
What don't you have to deal with when it comes to business?
Like when you're dealing with somebody and say, like you say, like these battle rappers or these artists or whatever, and they hit you and they say, oh, you know, I want to do this show, you know, put me on 11 o'clock. And you're like, well, nah, you got to start here. You know what I mean? And then work your way up. And then they get an attitude about it or whatever. You don't have to deal with that.
That's what I'm talking about being firm. You don't have to be like, fuck you, don't speak to him that way. It's like, look, dude, don't speak to me that way.
Yeah.
Like, well, what I say is this is what we're doing. If you want to rock with it, cool. If not, I totally understand. What can you say to that? You can't fight that. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
And you get to the point like, look, this is the way it is. You can either jump on or not. Like, that's
being firm. If not, you can go somewhere else. You know?
Yeah. You don't need to, like, just write them off the face. The biggest thing that Sire taught me was you never know. You never know. So even if you think someone's being a fucking piece of shit, and I've thought about this 1,000 times and just wanted to write them off, you never fucking know. You never fucking know.
Especially when people, you don't know if they, are you trying to say you don't know if they're being an asshole or?
You don't know if it'll be a good thing in the future. Maybe they're having a bad day. Maybe they said something the wrong way and you took it the wrong way.
Especially when you do things digitally. If you text somebody or email somebody, you never know how that point could get across or how that person could perceive things, right?
But what I say is if he's came to a point where he's disrespecting you, you know, you're kind of doing business with him. He's not your business partner per se. Can you trust a business partner like that you can't get along with? You know, like, you know, that decides one day he's having a bad day and he's just going to snap at you and
you. But sometimes you got to take things on the chin, right? If it makes sense. And, you know, you got to take stuff on the chin. Yeah. And this guy's being a dick, but you know what? He brought a lot of people to the venue tonight and we got to deal with it, you know?
Money talk.
It is what it is, man. So let's do this, Femini. Let's play your music video. Go ahead, introduce it, and we'll come back and we'll chop it up, man.
All right, my music video is going to call the Get It In.
Hold on. Let's relax. Take a step back. Start over. It's all good, man. Go for it.
Music video is called Get It In. You know, it's basically a music video that we decided to record. A lot of friends are going through stuff. We just wanted to have a good time. Recording a music video of us having a good time. You know, the 3 different spots. You know, we got a shop, or a store, or a house. I mean, we're just getting down in that video. Just having a lot of fun.
There you go. B-side form, baby.
Hope you guys enjoy.
B-side form.
All I know is that I never seen sober, never seen sober, never seen sober. When I roll in my Corolla, I was getting girls over. We just sitting at the spots, we was sipping on Corona. I be hitting on my boys, you be hitting on your crew. More girls than guys, and I'm easy getting to. Say, baby, what it do? But you really wanna chill? We can go to the bars, we can cruise up in the hills. There's very many places we can chill, getting crazy. Sipping on some brews, they were sniffing just blazing. Really, it's amazing, one call, made plans. We can go to the club, girl, we can even dance. Got third, got white, got green. Glass bottles in the back if you wanna drink. Puffing them tracks by Murphy on the beats. Do you dig that? Now tell me what you think. Tell me what you think. I'ma tell my boys they can roll up, roll up. You can tell your girls they can roll drink, get to know us. All you gotta do is just show up. I'ma tell my boys they can roll up, You can tell your girls they can roll up, Get another drink, get to know us, All you gotta do is just show up. All I know is that I never seen sober, I roll to the show, three blunts to the dome. Everyone's getting faded, how the fuck I'm getting home? Shit, shots on shots, so my record start to play. Got my boys, got my homegirls, we collaborate. Hit me up or you stab me when you feeling nasty. You already know, you just gotta get at me. I'm right here when you wanna come, let's kick it. When I'm in the studio, I'm on now, rapping. When I'm in the upper show, my mind's on my rapping show. I'm into to the world, what's good, what's living, it's me. The one you wanna be, when I'm in the focus, ain't nobody see me. I write my own rhymes and I'm murdering the show. I'm setting all my tickets, everybody wanna roll, I'ma tell my boys they can roll up, You can tell your girls they can roll up, Get another drink, get to know us, All you gotta do is just show up. I'ma tell my boys they can roll up, You can tell your girls they can roll up, Get another drink, get to know us, All you gotta do is just show up.
for work and had no type of luck. That's why I stick to this dough. 216 for the quarter, 5 for the half. You're looking at 11 for the all. I'm on deck with the soft, on deck with the hard. Every morning I wake up and I thank God. Then I grab the strap, go and brush my teeth. Once I'm done with that, then the nigga count his cheese. Make a few calls, then I cook up some yay. Let that shit dry, smoke some weed while I wait. Once that shit dry, then I see where they weigh. Chop up that dope, then I'm on my way, nigga. I'm feeling like the streets are my only friend. I'm feeling like cocaine is my only hope. I'm feeling like I'll probably never fucking win. I'm feeling like fuck this music, I should stick to selling dope. I'm feeling like the streets are my only friend. I'm feeling like cocaine is my only hope. I'm feeling like I'll probably never fucking win. I'm feeling like fuck this music, I should stick to selling dope. I should stick to selling dope. I should stick to selling dope. I should stick to selling dope.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Young Baki. You're back on the B-side form. My boy MC Remedy's coughing up a lung over here.
Yes, sir.
I think Blake's realizing he's had a little bit too much to drink too early, so he's trying to chill out.
That California air.
Alcatraz finally got some water, so he's living life, man.
He's drinking too much water.
What were you talking about during the break that you think MCs mimic other MCs?
Oh, I think that we're talking about the imagery and like the whole cockiness thing. You know what I'm saying? That's just dope. I love that beat.
Yeah, that's the best beat.
I just think that they emulate things. They emulate what they think they should be. You know what I mean? Like,
because that's easy, right?
Yeah, because it's easy to do. Like, you know, yeah, well, such and such says he thinks he's dope, so that's how I'm going to walk around. You know what I mean? And I was, tell me your name again. I'm sorry.
Yeah, Remedy.
Remedy.
Well, half an hour into this thing, you're still asking for his name.
No disrespect. I'm just like, you know what I mean? Like, my brain, man. I was telling Remedy, man, like, that's funny. I got a guy named Remy D battling on fucking on
which is super cool, man. I don't know when the last time Remy D battled.
It's been a minute.
It's been a minute. He's been going through some stuff, right? He openly talks about it.
Yeah. He's battling Fly King Eye. But what I was telling him was, so now the new age, and I think this is the confusion now. Like, now the new age rappers, they're not, like, before, back in the day, dudes that were cocky because they felt like they could spit. And that's what it was.
It was the worst.
Because they're rock stars, man.
Yeah, they can spit. You know, they had the mind to do it.
Now, that's the case now. Now they believe they're rock stars.
I'm a rock star.
The little Yachty's, the Uzi Verts, the
Kodak Blacks.
Well,
they are the modern day rock stars, right? Lil Uzi is a rock star.
No, they
Yachty
are,
is a rock
but they're not. But they're not cocky. I don't believe they're cocky because they actually think they're dope.
The rock stars.
They live this life and they're popping.
You can do what you want when you're popping. That's what I say all the time. You can do what
you want
when you're
popping. They're cocky because they're trending. They're cocky because they know they're trending.
But you can't be mad at them. You can't be mad at them because they found a lane, right?
No. Definitely not be mad at them. You got to respect them because they found a way to get into this art, which is music, you know, and make money out of it and make their dreams come true and come out of slums. Because you know what I'm saying? A couple of them I know were also living in the slums, living in problems, you know. Even though they didn't come up with the same hip hop culture, you know, they take it. It's a whole different idea for them. You know what I mean? I seen a lot of interviews, and they're like, when you ask them, you know, what do you consider yourself? Not. They don't say rapper. A lot of them don't say rapper. They always say something else, and it's that. I mean, that to me is a good thing, and they're cocky because of the money that they're getting. You know what
money
I mean? And I can't hate on them because, like he said, you know, they got this. You know, they got the watch, they got the ring, they got everything, you know, that they've always wanted. Why not be cocky? You know, like they work hard for it as well. You know what I mean? But
yeah,
it's a whole different kind of cocky than
what we
could have said. Because before it would be cocky because, you know, I got bars. And I know that my bars, I could walk into any spot and, you know, my cocky's telling me I could beat any rapper in there. My cockiness, that type of cockiness that was back then, was because they know what they had was great, you know. And now it's like, I'm cocky because I'm trending and I got it.
Because I got more money than you, because I have the...
That'll make somebody cocky,
the new
though, right?
This, the new that. Yeah, but that shit's corny.
Yeah.
I mean, I feel...
It's not hip-hop.
It's not culture. That's definitely not hip-hop. Like, I mean,
why is that not hip-hop? Money, bragging and posting about how much money and women you have, that's hip-hop, man.
That's hip-hop. That's hip-hop. Shitting on people because of it is not. And it was never, it was never.
Isn't hip-hop, don't I shit on you because you don't have as much money and you're not as popping as me? That's hip-hop. That goes back to the Bridges Over, man.
That they, when did they? They didn't talk about no money in that.
I'm saying back in that generation, even back then, they were talking about that. I'm better than you because I got this.
It wasn't
I'm
the only.
I'm popping. I'm going to club.
It wasn't the only topic though in the song. You know, like it was different.
Different. Yo, ahead, seated. What? To me, it's preference of music.
Yeah, but listen, you know, I would never downgrade or disrespect anybody because how much money they have or because of the pop. I would never do that.
Right.
But I could, you know, I can't blame this guy if that's how he makes a living. And that's what they just talk about how much. And I don't even think that they talk about, they talk down to you about not having money, but they brag about how much money they have, which gets them more money.
No, 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 no. They sit there and well, they get into beefs with little dudes.
But that's battle rap though too, isn't
it?
No, come on, man. Every battle rap, every battle rap I watch, one person's talking about this other person being broke.
Now you're talking about an art. Again, this goes back to separating the art from a personal, an actual personality. That's the difference, Bach. That's what I'm saying. Like, you're right. Yes, is it battle rap to be like, I'm better than you? Yeah, that, absolutely. Is that hip-hop? Yeah, it's not hip-hop. We all, when LL Cool J went back to the hood, do you remember when he came, I forgot what they were doing. I think it was EPMD, or I'm sorry, Public Enemy was doing something in the hood, you know, Fight the Power. LL Cool J came back with a mink coat on. Motherfucking star was like, boo, boo, what
the
are you doing?
The biggest thing that I would say that's not hip-hop about the new generation of these, I guess, rap genre.
Whatever you call them, yeah.
Is that it's all the same. That's the one thing I would say in back in the day.
And in 1990, everyone didn't sound the same?
You know what? You have a good point. You have a good point. A lot of it
all had the same style.
All had the same type of beats.
All had the same cadence.
You know what? Have a very good point.
That's why I have this show because I have great points.
I don't agree with that, though.
You don't agree with that? They all sound the same. They all had the same type of beats.
No, they were different. No. Very different.
But I think people would try more, a little harder to stand out than others in different styles. As far as you're talking about, like the Wu-Tangs, Mos Def.
They were all
DMX,
different.
Every Wu-Tang member, besides the 1%, besides the OTP, besides the Method Man, they all sound alike.
That was a crew, though. But they didn't sound
alike. All sound alike. But they besides the Method Mans, besides the ODBs,
like Wizard,
Inspector Tech, they all sound
they
alike.
They didn't sound like Nas. Nas didn't sound like Big.
No.
J.O. Felony didn't sound like Eazy-E. DJ Quick did not sound like MC8.
But 21 Savage doesn't sound like Lil Yachty either.
You know what? I'm going to say this. What makes them sound the same, you're right, because they don't necessarily sound the same, but this is what they're doing, and this is the thing that I'm saying. That's why the music's not the same. Like, MC8, his style was more blues hip-hop, whereas DJ Quick was more of like jazz hip-hop. You get what I'm saying? Uzi and them, they literally are doing trap beats, very similar trap beats, that kind of type shit. But they're different, but they're doing the same shit in terms of they're all using the melodies. They're similar melodies because I hear them and I'm like, damn, this shit kind of sounds exactly the same. Then almost all of them are using the fucking, what is that? That auto-tune shit. Okay. You get what I'm saying? So they're doing the same shit. Whereas when you had a DMX, like, he wasn't doing what Jay-Z was doing.
Or like, Marty.
You know what I mean? Like, yeah. X. Yeah,
who
you said who?
Well, DMX is, yeah. DMX is one of the most unique ones out of them all, though, too, right? Because he's the most raw, most passionate.
So was
and
Nas,
then Jay-Z.
Though.
Yeah,
so
but Jay-Z is more so smooth and more laid back. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure. For sure. But see, even then, there was always those styles, but there was always something that each artist did something, and that's what the new artists lack. Nothing new under the sun, but do something different.
Yo, Bob, are you going to tell me G-Unit all sounded the same? Lloyd Banks, 50?
No. They all had the same style.
Are you going to tell me they all sounded the same?
They all had the same style, 100%.
Because
they all talk about money and bitches.
The only thing I say about
I don't mean the same bitches.
Yeah,
but.
I mean, but they're crew, though.
Yeah.
I expect that from a crew.
It's frowned upon now.
I don't know if you do. I always expect that from a crew because if you rhyme with the same dudes, every day.
Because naturally, if you're in a studio with somebody for 6 months, you're naturally going to pick up on what they're doing. Yeah,
absolutely. Even like when Nelly came out and he had the Dirty ENT, whatever that.
Whole we all we got.
Yeah, they all like him, Murphy, Lee. They all. That
but then they're all from the same city too, so they all have the same style. Like yeah. Dipset is all from Harlem, and they all have that fly, flashy.
And
you know,
style. most of the Wu Tang, most of them were
from the same spot. Same so spots. You know, your nature is. You know, nature over nurture, as people have a discussion all the time.
Yeah.
The nature, I believe, has more to do with it. Yeah. But when it comes to battle rap, I don't want to keep saying every time I do this, but one of my biggest dislikes of battle rap is that people are mimicking people. So yeah. This battle rapper sees this guy that's on the main stage doing this, I'm going to copy that.
Yeah.
Where do you draw the line between art and lifestyle? Somebody that you know that has a 9-to-5 that's a square, talk about he's going to shoot you in the face. Is that acceptable in battle rap?
Is it acceptable? I think it becomes acceptable if they're able to sell it to people. It's like Rick Ross. We know he was a CEO. We know
he sells it so good, right?
But the fucking album he just put out, bro, the beats,
amazing.
The style, the flow, like what he did. Like, I mean, honestly, at this point, I'm like, bro, you could have been a drug dealer. I mean, maybe.
He sells it.
You could have been Pablo, huh?
Listen, Tupac was a ballerina, you know?
Man.
Biggie's mom said that he never went for anything.
Right.
So where you sell it. So is that the same thing in battle rap?
Yeah.
If somebody could sell it, it's all good.
It's all good. Because, like, I mean, you just, everything is, it's all entertainment. You know what I'm saying? And I think the whole era of, like, oh, you know, people not keeping it real. Like, bruh, like, even, I'm pretty sure even though Biggie's mom said he never needed it for anything, that's from her perception of saying, I provided for my son. But Biggie spoke from a perspective of, like, I didn't have everything I wanted.
I didn't get those new kicks.
Yeah,
I didn't, you know what I mean?
I still, like, if we had everything, I wouldn't have had to sell this dope. He might have not been no kingpin, you know, like he might say, but he sold dope.
He knows how it feels to wake up fucked up. Yeah. Pockets broke as hell. Another Brock to sell.
That is a good point. Yeah. That is a good point. I'm going to tell you the most original person in battle rap right now is Fly King. Fly King, you talk about being real, being yourself. Yeah. Fly King doesn't change for anybody.
No.
He'll walk into a grimy spot like the airliner wearing a pink mink coat and a crown on his head, and he doesn't kill. That's what we want out of people, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Fly King's literally one of my favorite battle rappers right now.
Nah, he's dope, man. He's dope. And he's been working a lot with Sarah Connor now. They're building the Prison Battle League over there in New York, which is basically like a LGBT movement for battle rap.
Let's give it up to battle rap for supporting that, right?
Yeah.
I mean, look, bro, at the end of the day, man, people are people, bro. I had this girl tell me the other day, and she was like telling me, like, because she somehow a conversation came up about gay people, and she was like, oh, you shouldn't have an opinion. Like, nobody who's not gay shouldn't have an opinion. And I'm like, okay. She's like, if you have an opinion, you're like in the closet gay. You're in a closet homosexual. And I'm like, you're allowed to tell me what you want to tell me about it, but I can't respond.
Well,
okay,
I could,
whatever.
You know, I might not be Chinese, but I enjoy Chinese food, right?
There you go.
Like, I'm allowed to have an opinion about anything.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we're allowed to have an opinion about anything.
Blake, tell me how stressful it is being the booking manager of Los Clubos. It has to just drive you nuts, right?
It doesn't. I honestly love my job. I love it. There, of course, is parts of it that drive me crazy as far as, you know, how one person says one thing and then it's another. The hardest part is the deals that are sometimes made and sometimes the stuff that happens in the industry as far as dates being moved around and shit. You and I have experienced that, and that shit sucked.
And it's frustrating because whoever's your boss might go above your head and switch something around, but you're the guy that has to tell the person, hey, we got to do this.
Well, there's levels. Like, for example, I can access our private calendar, but I can't change things in the calendar. I have to email someone to add these dates onto the calendar, and if stuff gets changed, sometimes you won't get notified. You know, you have to pay attention to the dates. Most of the times, there is very good communication, but we book you know how Los Globos is.
So many different shows every night.
Yeah.
So many different types of genres and
got art
different
shows
deals.
Out there.
And
I've been to a couple art shows there.
Yeah. Just after hours that go until 6 a.m., which is nuts.
You have about like 5-6 shows one night. one night.
Crazy, dude.
You have early shows, you have normal running time shows, you have after hour shows, and then you have two floors, and then we're booked all the way to July.
Yeah. So, are you guys really booked to July?
Yes.
That's impressive.
I'm not fucking lying to you. It's like the hard. Weekends are the toughest. Weekends are really hard to get people in.
Well, because whoever you have, the promoters that you have on the weekends now are making so much money. If you can't come up, if you can't make that much money at the bar, you can't even play with the big boys yet. Most people should understand. I understand that.
That's
like my company can't make that X amount of dollars at the bar on a Saturday night.
Yeah, and I have Ellie Got Aloha on a Friday, and I'm scared shitless about that.
You should be scared. Yeah. I would be scared. I wouldn't be able to go to sleep. What date do you have that?
July 21st.
Yeah, you should.
Yeah.
You should be scared.
It's my birthday. Yeah. I might have to go there.
Yeah. So and I know like the bar needs to make 6.5K minimum. This is minimum. This is not like, you know, like you need to aim for like some of the bars do 10K. So there's a lot of pressure, and you got a lot of the biggest thing that people don't understand is while they're booking shows is you got to be careful because everyone's going to overhype their stuff, and that's fine. As a booker, you know that that's what's going to happen. You basically cut in half whatever that they're throwing at you, or you ask for proof. You know, you look at previous events that they do, whatnot. But
yo, you better finish all this, man. We're not taking this home.
You know I'm finishing all this because I got somebody driving me home today. So
there you go. There you go. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, man. No worries. But it's a lot. A big thing that people don't understand is the overhead. You're if you fuck up, you're fucking up with people's paychecks. You know what I mean? You have the bartenders. You have security. You have the cost of the venue. Your cost of expenses, like beer, like that shit doesn't come free. And a lot of people think that it does, and I get so upset when they're like, okay, I'm not booking your shows because you're saying you can only bring 100 people and you're trying to book a Saturday. Sorry, let's try it for a Tuesday.
They don't understand that though, right?
No, so they don't. A lot of people don't.
Especially the rapper saying, hey, I want to hit your email saying, hey, I want to have an album release party on this Saturday from 9 to 2 a.m. I could bring 80 people, and you say, well, that's not enough. They say, what do you mean it's not enough, you know? It's a tough business, man.
Yeah, exactly.
It really is.
It is. You have to be very firm on what you know, your view is, what needs to happen. It's very clear, cut and dry. And when it makes it your job, though, it makes it a little bit easier because you're like, it's either this or it's that. Like, look, you can go to no disrespect. They're all great.
Call out names, Blake. Call out the names, Blake. Call it out, man.
If you're starting out, do the Silver Lake Lounge. If you want to go something smaller, do the downstairs at Airliner or, you know, build up.
Now you're calling out too much names, Blake. Now you're going a little bit too far, man. I was all for it, man.
I said the downstairs.
Messing with my money, man.
I said the downstairs.
The Airliner's a great thing.
Yeah, Airliner is a fantastic venue, which is why I started saying not down.
I'll see you guys.
Cut off his mic, Shay. He's done, man. Fuck you guys, done. No, but you have a good point. If you want to do an album release party, and you're gonna bring 80 people, book downstairs at
just
Airliner.
Or
we got three stages coming.
Or our own venue, book the Red Room, that holds 80 people. But people get so offended by that, and it's like, no, fuck that. I need the big room. It's like, well, then put, I don't know your event, put down a $500 rental fee in this guarantee. And they say, no, I still don't want to do that. And you know what? That's fine. But when they get upset with you, it's like, dude, I'm trying to help you.
That's the stupid part right there, bro. Like, it took me a while to figure it out, but that shit makes sense, bro. Like, that's why now, you know, you just ask questions. Hey, Bach, I wanted to get this place. You know, how much can I get it for? This amount. How many people do you think you can bring? This is the amount of people I can bring. I don't know if that's going to work out, Traz. We need X amount. I'm like, shit, I don't think I can do that, bro. Fuck it, you know. Bach is the type of dude that'd be like, well, shit, check out this other spot. You know what I mean? Like that. Like
that's how you do it.
That's helpful. You know what I mean? Just like you said, you might tell them, hey, but for people to get offended because you're telling them that's
disrespectful. Right, you're trying to help them
because
out
it all comes back to what we talk about. You're dealing with people that have a big egos and they're egotistical.
Oh yeah.
So it's when you say that show isn't worth our time on a Saturday night, they're saying you're not worth our time on a Saturday night, and they're like, well, you don't know how dope I am. That's fine. Be as dope as you want. But if you can't bring X amount of people to our venue at this time, then what's the point? It's a business.
Just like he said.
But you know what? Once you say it's a business, you have people like, oh, well, you know, I do this for the love. Okay, no, for the love, that's fine.
But for the love doesn't pay the bills. How about you go to work every day, not get paid, and then tell them, oh, it's just for the love. Make that coffee.
I got a lot of love for you, though.
Blake, yeah, you seem like somebody that said you do it for the love once in a while.
Sorry.
Early in your career, 5-6 years ago, you looked like you did it for the love.
Oh, hip-hop. I did. Absolutely did it for the love. But I didn't. I can promise you that I've never pushed that onto someone else. I've never done that. It is what I've been persuasive. I'm like, come on, dude, this will be cool. Like, it has a great idea. But I don't think I've ever pushed it onto someone to say, do it for love. And you know what? At the same time as I get irritated about it, it's still fine. It is their passion. They're trying all that they can to try and book this show. But, like, in my head, it's like, yeah, I have never heard that before. You know, so it's kind of hard. But really what it boils down to is how they react to it. You know, if they get upset, it's like, dude, calm your tits. Relax. Fucking you will be big one day if you don't bitch like that.
Well, it comes back to what we talked about, entitlement, right? So what do you have somebody that comes to, hey, Alcatraz, I'm the best battle rapper coming up. I need a battle with B-Dot. Let's make it happen, dude. You have to get those conversations all the time, right? Where people say, I need to get a big name.
Yeah, I mean, I just pretty much shut it down. I mean, I'm like, who have you battled? Like, what have you done? Like, I'm not an asshole about it. I'm just like, seriously, bro. Like, these are real questions. Like, I'll tell them straight up. Like, you know, and my thing is, everything is conversation and how you say things. And I'm like, bro, I'm not trying to be an asshole. Do you understand what this guy was able to do in a matter of a year and a half? Like, he had viral videos, you know, clips that went viral over 9 million views.
And people that had no interest in battle rap, but that got their attention.
Right.
It crossed over more than just battle rap community.
It caught my attention. B-Dot video caught my rap. Because honestly, man, I was more focused on making songs and freestyling sessions, not the battle rap aspect of it, even though I love the battle rap aspect of it. But I you know what I'm saying? I like doing as a rapper, like where you know, make a song or, you know, a freestyle how I feel on a whole track or something like that. And thanks, man. And so, like, watching one of those videos, actually, my cousin Ricky put me on that B-Dot video. Hey, bro, from Washington. He's like, you haven't heard of B-Dot? I was like, nah. Watch this video. Send me a link right away. And that's when I got started. Oh, shit. Damn. Well, you know what? I might want to get involved in something like this.
That's the system working, right? That's what we want. We wanted to have that.
And these guys that come through and they're talking about, like, yeah, I want a shot at B-Dot. I'm like, bro, I can't. This is the other thing, too. This is the biggest thing that, for some odd reason, battle rappers and for whatever reason don't think of is, I can't make him battle you. You know what I mean? Number two, I'm not going to, because B-Dot's worth money now, I'm not going to pay him his fee to battle you. I have nothing invested in you. I don't know you.
I
mean.
They don't see that side. They don't see how much people walk in the door. And it just doesn't happen, man. Yeah. You know?
Like this.
A lot of
this,
people don't.
This Saturday.
A lot of people.
April 15th. At the Airliner, when we do the
one of the greatest venues in America right now.
When we do our LA Beef 3 event, OGs versus BGs, we have like 4 or 5 different MCs, bro, flying themselves out to do CDFs. You know what I mean? We're talking.
And CDFs, for the people that don't know, is Catch the Fade, right?
Catch that fade, which is
your Fortune Proving Grounds.
Exactly. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's their tryout. You know, they show us what they can do, and then we can see how they move along onto, you know, through the rankings. Because a lot of times, too, that's another thing, man. Sometimes these battles make themselves, bro. Somebody might see him, one of the newcomers, and they're like, I'll give this new dude a shot, bro. You know what I mean? Shoot me. Hey, Traz, let me get a little change. You know what I mean? I'll kill this dude. And, you know, this dude, you know, it just depends. Sometimes it's just investment, you know. Some guys are willing to invest in themselves. That's the other thing. You know, because a lot of money goes into these. Just like you guys throw events and shit, it's the same thing with battle rap, bro. You got the DJ. You got the venue.
You out of Field Remedy? You gone? Okay. Do your thing. Yeah, it's fine.
See you later.
All right, go ahead. Yeah. We're not filming a live show or anything. It's fine. Just get up in the middle and go. It's
I got to make room because I
there you go. There you
gotta,
go.
I got to drink
I
all
never,
these.
It's like you want me to finish everything.
I've never
hey, I gotta finish
seen
everything.
Somebody just get up in the middle of a conversation.
Just put, you see this water bottle?
Yo,
don't let it stop you. I mean, go do your thing.
I was really use the bathroom.
I was like, you know what?
There you go, girl.
I misunderestimated my bladder for
there
a second.
There you go. There you go.
You know what I'm saying?
Remedy's trash right now, dude.
No, not trash. Not yet. Like, after I drink a couple more of these, I let you know our track. You know, I got a designated driver. You got to
let the
safe,
man pee in peace, bro. Go ahead, Jesus, go ahead. Baka.
No, it's cool. We need to start restricting how much alcohol we serve to some people, right?
Oh, no.
Go do your thing. Come on, put your mic down. Go do your thing, man. Go do your thing. There you go. So these, you have battle rappers that believe in themselves, so they want to invest money into their own, in their passion to fly themselves out. They get to catch the fade, and if it goes great like they expect it to go great, then they can start moving up the ladder. Absolutely. And then that's how they start making a name for themselves in battle rap.
Yeah, and it's just that simple, man. And you know, it's like,
but you say it's that simple, but a lot of these people don't understand that concept. Maybe 20% of the industry understand.
Well, this is what happens. They go, "Oh, I'm the hottest dude in my area," and it's like, okay,
in Kansas City, right? The hottest guy.
Like, yeah, okay, Kansas City, and it's like, okay, cool. And then you watch their videos and you're like, dope. Are those people going to come fly out here and watch you battle? Like, are you going to bring those people? Like, what are you know? And then even on top of that, the video might have like 1,000 views, 2,000 views. And it's like, okay, so like, what am I going to do with that? Like, why would I spend, you know, $300-$400 to fly you out, another $200-$300 on a hotel, and you know what I mean, and then you might be asking for some money, which I'm probably not gonna pay you. You know what I mean? Like, why would I do all that? Like, for 2,000 views?
Because, like my boy Blake said, you do it for the love. That's why. The love of battle rap. That's why.
Yeah,
you do
bro.
It.
Yeah. Come on.
Come on, man. You don't.
I mean,
you
don't get me wrong. I love battle rap, but then there's a difference between what you do for love and then the business aspect. But that's the whole thing, bro. And that's what separates artists, businessmen, different people from just regular people that are just like, oh, do it for the love. Yeah. Most of those people that say do it for the love, that's not what they mean. They're saying, I don't have the finances for this right now. Can you hook me up?
Yeah, they're just trying to persuade you. It's their sales pitch, and that's fine.
Well, yeah, like, if they persuade you and they get it, then good for them.
Yeah,
you know?
Right. All you have to do is be like, look, man, like, we just can't afford that. Like, you know, hopefully in the future we can work together. Like,
right.
But the thing is, you get that in such a large quantity that it's so hard to keep your calm all the time. Like, I sense your frustration, like, when you talk about it. And I'm not lying. I have the same frustration too. But it really is how you come off with the person. You know, you have to. Like, and granted, yeah, you're going to slip from time to time. We're only fucking human. But, yeah, you got to keep your calm. And you just say, look, man, we can't afford it at the moment. I appreciate you hitting me up. I would love to work with you in the future. Let's keep in touch.
Well, we talked about, you said you have all these people saying, hey, give me this much money. And you know, because you've been in the industry for so long, that they're only going to bring out 12 people. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So you kind of want to just smack them up the head and say, what the hell are you talking about, right?
Of course, yeah.
Just give them a little backhand one time.
You get upset. Yeah, of course. You're going to think that way.
So how do you not backhand people? Like,
it's because it probably wouldn't look good. It probably wouldn't look good, and you never know. You never know, and, you know, I try to treat other – the motto my whole entire life has been treat other people the way you want to be treated. And every single time I was so close to saying, shut the fuck up. I don't want to hear you talk. Go home and talk to your mom. I tell myself, I wouldn't want to be told that. Although I would be like, you know what, you're right. I probably will go home and talk to my mom and figure life out. But – it just probably wouldn't feel good, so I just don't say it.
Like 100%.
Yeah, it sounds like a personal problem to me, right?
Talking to your mom?
I feel, huh?
So what's the big event you got coming up at Los Globos, man? What's the next thing you're promoting?
I have this Sunday. Sorry. I have Ohana Tree this Sunday. Yeah, bro.
Webby is so drunk right now, right? You're just so gone, dude.
This is water, man. You know, I drink King Cobra and Hurricane a lot.
Listen, I don't think anyone past the age of 12 drinks a King Cobra, man.
King Cobra and Hurricane, no. Oh, wait. That's what I drink.
I want to get one battle off camera, one round, and I believe that I would just kill it.
Okay.
Right, so we'll settle.
Why is it going to be off camera?
Because I don't want on cap. I'm trying to be city councilman one day. I don't want the camera to see me say all these non-politically correct things, you know.
Yeah. Anyway,
what's
Sunday.
Up, man? Sorry about that.
Guys, Sunday.
Sorry, everybody jacked it up for you, dude.
It's okay.
Yeah,
no, it's
Sunday at Los Globos, we have Ohana Tree. Ohana Tree was an event that we did at the Dragonfly, and it did really well. It was basically the sister event of LA Got Aloha, and is coming to Los Globos for the first time April 16th, which, again, is this Saturday. We have the Four Horsemen Tour, which is B. Dolan from Strange Famous Records, which is what Sage Francis does, for everyone that doesn't know. We have DJ Abilities from Rhymesayers, Cast One versus Figure, Dope Knife from Rising Suns Independent. We have Bissetry, myself, Analog Dive, and Free Will.
Yo.
You broke it.
Yeah, I think. Let me. Yeah. I'm not going to switch mics with you. Bissetry is the person that made the Anna Baca Foundation logo and the Young Baca Productions logo, too. So he holds a special place in my heart, dude.
Bissetry does do all the graphic design at Rising Suns Independent. So, yeah, we all pull our own weight, and there's a reason that it has been going the way that it is, and it definitely wouldn't be there if it wasn't for the gentleman that stand behind me. It's basically me, John, Bissetry, Free Will, Willie, and Ed Rock One, Eddie Flores. Eddie Flores is the art coordinator. So we all do our own thing. We all pull our own weight. And, yeah, that's Rising Suns Independent. And that's the event we're doing this Sunday is Ohana Tree at Los Globos.
Let's stop promoting the July event right now so we can hit that ball, Kendi. What's the July event?
The July event is LA Got Aloha.
There you go. Just give me the date. Give me the date.
July 21st.
There you go. Traz, what you got popping, man? What's your big event coming up, man? The reason you're sitting in this seat right now.
This Saturday, man, LA Battlegrounds presents LA Beef 3 at the Airliner. Doors open at 8 p.m. OGs versus BGs. Headlining is Young Cannon versus Strick. It's going to be a huge battle. Geechee Gotti versus Link. Remy D versus Fly King. I mean, Yak versus Saint. Like, it's a lot of different battles.
How many battles in total do you have?
I think we got about close to 10.
Is it unprofessional if I ask you to give me predictions on each battle?
No. I mean, is that what you want me to do?
I want you to tell me who you think you're going to win. Somebody that sets it up. The Chess Master. Yeah. The West Coast, what did you call it? What did you call yourself? West Coast personnel.
Well, before I do that, also we have August Blue and B-Dot performing. So shout out to them.
Nice.
They'll be performing. You know, their music. That's what the platform's for. All right, well here's the list.
Let's do it. I'll ask you. All right. So Link versus Gotti.
Mm-hmm.
Who's taking that, man?
I think Gotti is a favorite, and I think Gotti,
Say what you're looking. You're thinking of something right now that you're saying, maybe I shouldn't say that.
No, because...
Say it.
No, because I think that Link can win, but I think that Geechee Gotti is the crowd favorite, so he's not going to have to work as hard to win the battle.
Is that something that frustrates you in battle rap? The fact that you have crowd favorites?
No, not to me, because I feel like even when you have a crowd favorite, like, it's still an MC skill. So when people complain, oh, the crowd was gassing them, well, guess what? You're an MC. You should be able to win the crowd back. Like, that's what you're supposed to do.
You can even win their crowd. Yeah. All right,
so let's go Saint vs. Yak the Ripper. I really enjoy Yak. He's literally one of my favorite battle rappers. But is he going to take this battle? I had to think about this. This isn't
you
the first
funny?
Time I've asked you.
No. I mean, I don't, though, because when I think of battles, I just think of how dope will they be and, like, how will the matchups kind of pan out. Like, will it be a dope battle?
Because you're on the
battle?
Business side. You don't think about who's going to win this. You're saying, yeah. Hey, you know, what are we going to pull out of this?
Right.
So who's taking that?
Honestly, I have a feeling when the lights are on and everything is said and done, I don't know why I have a feeling Saint's going to keep it together and Yak might possibly have some slip-ups. But if I'm wrong, I'm wrong.
So you're going with Saint, though?
Yeah, I'm going to go with Saint in that one.
I'm only going to ask you the major battles, man. One of my favorite battles, like battle rappers, like I just told you, Fly King versus Remy D. Is Remy D going to be sober enough for this battle?
I don't think he's going to have enough for Fly King.
Yeah.
I just don't. I mean, you know. Respect to dude for what he's done, but Fly King is just kind of like, you know, dude's very comfortable in what he does. He's comfortable in his skin.
He's comfortable in his skin, and that's all we could wish for, right?
Yeah.
Just to be comfortable in our skin.
Like, I felt, you know, and that's the one thing, that's why I said with the Link battle, that's why I thought about it, because I told Fly King, I'm like, you know, I think Link got you. You know what I mean? I think Link got you, and he was like, no, I was saying the hotter shit, and I was like, you did have some hot shit, and, you know, but Link just kind of controlled the room that night.
And having hot shit is just, that's just one element of it, right?
Yeah.
Especially in front of a live crowd.
Yeah.
You know, crowd control is one of the biggest things that people don't understand that.
You have to have the aura. The crowd has to feel you. Yeah. I definitely get up, especially since most of the people in that crowd also rap. Most of the people in that crowd also rap, you know? So
a lot of them do.
A lot of them, though, you know, they won't follow you unless you got that type of aura where you're like, damn, okay, he's saying some stuff. But if he's not saying what he has to say, that crowd's not going to follow.
Yeah. You know what I mean? And listen, if you're hot, you're hot. If not, there's no excuses for it, you know? And that's what you need to tell these guys, man. So let's do Element versus, is that Dubai? How you pronounce that?
Dopey.
So who's taking that? Element versus Dopey?
I think Dopey's going to do his shit. I have a feeling that... I'm going to say this. If Element comes on his shit, I think his energy is a little bit too much for Dopey. I think he outperforms him and he wins. Did he not come well prepared? Because, you know, maybe...
But that's an easy thing to say, right? If he comes prepared, he's going to get it. Do you think he's going to come prepared?
I mean, I want to say yeah, but the thing is, you'd be surprised how these dudes like think. They're like, oh, this dude's like, oh, this dude can't beat me. You know what I mean? And then you show up and get your ass kicked because you didn't take it serious.
But it happens in fights, in boxing matches all the time, right? UFC matches all the time. You underestimate someone, you get your ass beat.
Yep.
Right here, man. Let's go No Bad versus Demigod. Demigod.
I think that's going to be a great battle. I'm going to edge that right now to Demigod.
There you go. Who's your headliner on this card, man?
YK versus Young Cannon versus Strick.
You think you said Strick's going to get that one, right?
I think Strick should win.
Should win or is going to win?
He should win.
So for the people that don't know, we'll do this at the Airliner Saturday night. What time do the doors open?
8 p.m.
8 p.m.
Airliner, man.
One of the LA best venues in America, like we said, right, Blake?
I said not one word about that venue. Listen,
just because you say no disrespect doesn't mean there's not disrespect involved in it, right?
I wanted to make sure it didn't get twisted, but it still did.
Okay, there you go.
I'm performing there tomorrow.
There you go.
I'm
there tomorrow. On Friday night.
Yeah, Friday night.
Hey, Remedy's so just trash right now, right?
What I meant to say is the downstairs isn't it smaller than the downstairs at Los Lobos.
Listen, man, just stop digging yourself out of the hole. So, Trash, let me ask you a question. If somebody wants to get, somebody believes in themselves as a battle rapper, how can they get in touch with you as far as getting on the card?
Just email us, LA Battlegrounds, LA Battlegrounds with an S at gmail.com. Or get us on at us on the Instagram and the Facebook, LA Battlegrounds with a Z.
And what is something that you're looking for in a battle rapper? Is it just you want to see the numbers they got?
No, not at all. I mean, sometimes that has nothing to do with it when they're trying to come up. There's some of them just have a star quality, you know what I mean? And sometimes certain, like West Coast Dread, I didn't see it in him. Wood seen it in him.
Listen, West Coast Dread is amazing. Why isn't West Coast Dread battling me?
West Coast Dread went through some things in life, and then he got himself together. And when he got himself together, he focused on that. He focused on his son. He focused on his job that he had gotten. He's married now. You never know. I mean,
good
could.
For him, right? That's all we could ask for, man. Take care of your family, you know, walk your ass off, and it is what it is, man.
I'm going to tell you something, and this is something that LA Battlegrounds prides themselves. He was going through something very serious before that Clutch battle, man. And without saying too much, he just wasn't in the best shape. And that battle, he told Woods himself, he was like, it snapped him out of his rut. Like, it brought him back to reality. I don't know what it was, bro, but he...
Music does that to you.
Yeah, it was... Medicine. It was therapy, absolutely, you know.
Listen, Danny Myers versus West Coast Dread is one of the best battles I've seen live. And it truly was amazing. And anyone that listens to me talk about battle rap, I tell them all the time, man.
You know, Danny Myers is literally the West Coast gatekeeper. Like, he's the only one right now, to me. Like, if you beat Danny Myers, or you get to the level of battling a Danny Myers that he'll battle you, he's a gatekeeper, man. Like, that's, you know, from that point you just can only elevate.
What's hip hop Alcatraz's state of West Coast battle rap right now? What do you think it's at?
It's in a good place.
It's a good place?
Yeah, it's in a good place. Relationships are being built. You know what I mean? I've been talking a lot to KG the Poet with Smack URL West, PG thing going on. You know, talk to J Pro. You know what I mean? If you notice, I'm at a lot of King of the Dot events also. You know, you just have all these different, you know, leagues popping up. You know, again, the one thing, I think it's in a great state, man. The one thing that I think that we do still, and I always say this from all the other leagues that are out here, is we're consistently finding new talent. And we don't just, like, you can bring new guys.
It's easy to fly somebody in, right? It's easy to fly somebody in and put these two cats together. But to go to the place that you guys go to, battling in front of Watts Towers, that's how you got to produce new talent, right?
You produce new talent, but also, I mean, actually looking at what, you know, seeing and scouting what you're seeing, then talking to them and, you know, making them understand that, hey, you have the ability to possibly be, you know, make a name for yourself in this. You know what I'm saying? And it's happened over and over. Like Dre Vicious, for example. Dre Vicious, he had people telling him he was going to battle. He should battle. Arsenal were his friends, all these dudes that he knew, but he wasn't doing it. And I remember I met him at my studio, you know, this was years ago. And I was like, yeah, bro, you should battle. He's like, yeah, you know the homie Arsenal. He's been telling me, blah, 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 blah. Well, finally, I got him to do it. I booked the Daylight versus Fats. Yeah, I mean, that was the headliner. That was when he did his antic with the KKK. We had Active that night on that card, and we had Dre Vicious.
He just lined it up. He had all his homies, so this is the perfect place to do it.
It was
right?
Perfect yeah. For him to do it. And, I mean, literally after that point, man, he battled for us probably maybe like two or three times. And then A-Hat kind of like, see, there's leagues that'll go, oh, they got somebody hot. You know, let's get them. But the problem with battle rap, I think, sometimes is these leagues will get somebody because they believe they're hot, and then they start to oversaturate them. You know what I mean? And
well, it's just stretching yourself thin, right?
Absolutely.
The more shows that somebody does, the less crowd are going to bring out.
But it's because they start putting a couple dollars in their pocket, which I get it. You know what I mean? I understand. Everybody wants to get paid, right?
Well, especially if you're young, up-and-coming battle rap. If someone's going to give you cash, you accept every deal, right?
Yeah. That's a big thing.
Well, no, but that's not the case, because at that point, if you
For someone that sees the big picture, it's not the case. But right. For somebody that's hungry and you accept everything you get, you know?
No, absolutely. And then, you know, you just build, you know, your repertoire. Now, like, look at, like, Dre Vicious, you know what I mean? He went, he did his thing with A-Hat, you know? Then now he's still doing it because A-Hat has different, like, chapters. So he's traveling here, he's traveling there, you know, he's doing his thing. So you can do that. And that's what we try to tell these other young guys coming up. We're like, okay, you know, because that's their whole thing. They want to be like Dre Vicious. They want to be like B-Dot. They want to be like Street. They're watching us. It's funny to know that that people are watching us how people watch URL. That's hilarious to me. Like, I have a dude on Facebook that, like, I comment on his stuff. He's like, I can't believe you comment on my stuff. Like, what?
You're popping, Traz. Man.
It's funny to me, though. It's funny to me because it's just like, okay, well, cool. Like, I'm still a regular human being, bro. Your shit was funny. Like, you know
what I mean? That's how Blake feels, too, being the gatekeeper of Silver Lake, dude. You know?
Man, that's tight, dude. So can we get, like, free tacos and stuff? Like, dude, can you hook that up? Because I'm hungry right now.
Listen, the stuff that Blake's offering, you don't want anything to do with it. You know what I'm saying? So just, you know, it is what it is.
The best tacos in Silver Lake.
So L.A. Battlegrounds, that's where you see them first, right?
Where you see them first.
And that's a big claim. And that's a big – you guys should really hang your hat on that, because it's easy for these other leagues like a, Proving Grounds, whatever, to fly people in and see that they're popping. But you guys go out and you find talent and you – it's like a farm system. It's homegrown, man. And that's something you guys should really be proud of.
Yeah, no, absolutely, man, and thank you. I mean, we definitely do, you know what I mean? In terms of our niche, too, don't get that twisted. Like, King of the Dot have their own thing, yeah. You get what I'm saying? Like, they find their own talent. Like, that's how you get new guys in their circle. And, you know, obviously URL, they do the same thing, you know what I'm saying? But there's a lot of leagues. Like, I'll give you case.
There's a lot of leagues that just fly guys in.
Yeah, that's it.
There's a lot of leagues
and then they try to get names that are already – established. Like, oh, you know, they're over there popping, so let's get them over here.
Which maybe is easy. It's easy to sign the free agents than developing a farm system.
Right.
That's just the case of it, you know?
Right.
In baseball and battle rap, it's easier to sign the free agents, you know?
Yep. Yep.
Remedy, man, where can they find you at?
You can find me on Instagram, Remedy is, Facebook.
I've never seen someone in the B-side form you know, that has gotten this drunk and so gone before.
No, this is water, man. I'm good now. You can find me on Facebook, Instagram, SoundCloud is where I have all my music, where I post all my new music. Yo, MC Remedy 818 and everything. And on Instagram, on Facebook, it's MC Remedy. I'll be probably the only Latin MC Remedy. The only other MC Remedy is a DJ from Europe, which is, you know.
You're going to take him out, right?
No, he's good. He's a DJ, you know what I mean? If he was an MC, then we'd have to battle. You know, I did go against another MC.
You did a
MC
battle Remedy at Los Globos, they were racist, right?
No, you know what? They weren't racist. What happened in this battle rap was that.
Just because Blake's here, let's not sugarcoat the story.
No, this exactly. No, I'm explaining.
You said Baca. Hold on. You said who's going to be on the show?
No.
You said who's going to be on the show? You said who is going to be on the show? And I said, Blake, he's the booking agent at Los Globos. And you said,
I didn't even know.
What did you say? You said, I don't fuck with Los Globos. And I said, why do you say that? Los Globos is a great venue. They show Young Bach Productions a lot of love. It's awesome.
That was a rap battle.
And hold on. And you said, those fuckers are fucking racist. I said, what are you talking about? So just because Blake said, let's not sugarcoat it, right?
Yeah, this is how it went down. This is how it went down in reality. I was freestyle battling, you know, I was at a good position, you know. The only bad part was that, you know, there was like maybe I could count the Hispanics and, you know, my hands, you know what I'm saying? I was like, damn, this many Hispanics, three of them are girls.
What was the other demographic?
It was African American.
Hold on. You didn't say African American.
What was the other demographic?
It was African American.
You didn't say African American when you told me the story, though.
So
you said that a different word for it.
I said that the person was mad because I was working a grave shift while they work in a slave ship. And you know.
I wonder why they were mad, right? I wonder why they were upset.
It got pretty racial. But at the same time, you know, I only brought like five people. You know what I mean? Like the five Hispanics that were there. You know, and then I was like, man, you know what? A lot of people were like, damn, I can't believe you said that. But at that time, like the lyrics were good enough for me not to get jumped on the way out. You know what I'm saying?
And then you won.
Yeah, I lost in the radio as far as the crowd.
There you go.
Because I heard the crowds every You know, you know when you say something and the crowd is like, he said that. He really said that. Damn.
What did you think when he said that?
When I said that,
so
and
let
I
the
felt
people
the tension.
Let the people know. Let the people know your Instagram, your SoundCloud, all that good stuff, man.
MC Remedy 818 at Instagram, Facebook, SoundCloud, MC Remedy 1. I hope you guys like enjoy my music as well.
There you go, man.
Right on.
Blake, what you got coming up? Where can the people find you at? If they want to get in contact with you, we're going to get in contact with you.
Yeah, well, earlier we said what I got coming up Sunday, Ohana Tree, Los Globos.
There you go.
Yeah, make sure you go. You can get tickets on rsimusic.com. That's where you can also find my music. My name is Analog Dive, so you can find me on there under the artist section. You can look me up on Facebook, Instagram, SoundCloud. Just type in Analog Dive.
There you go. I like the hand action.
Well, because people think it's drive.
Mr. Alcatraz, where can the people find you at, sir?
You can find me personally at Hip Hop Alcatraz, HIPHOPALKATRAZ, and at LA Battlegrounds for the movement, LA Battlegrounds with a Z.
There you go. This Saturday night, right?
Saturday night,
Airliner. One of the best venues in America.
Those Globos and the Airliners are great places to perform at.
Sorry if everybody's speaking over you, dude.
No, it's all good. So good. LA Beef 3.
There you go. OGs versus the YGs.
BGs.
Sorry about that. We got at DJ Nympho on the ones and twos. We got at Shay Whitey on the boards. He's controlling all the cameras. My boy Remedy's going to finish up all this bill. You know where you can find me at Young Baca, at Young Baca Productions. Thursday night, we have Band Night at the Airliner. And we have Nintendo 64 night at the bunker.
I'm always there. They're throwing darts. I'll probably be up Baca this
darts,
week.
Right? Friday night, We the West, world famous airliner. Saturday night, LA Battlegrounds, airliner. We got a lot of stuff popping, man, at Young Baca Productions. YoungBachProductions.com. We out of here, baby. At B-Side Forum. Follow us.